A lot of this is going to be in your AP exam. All right, let's talk about things that we've talked about in this class before. In 1676, during the colonial era, when we were still the 13 colonies before the American Revolution, there was this thing called Nathaniel Bacon's Rebellion. Put Bacon's Rebellion over there. And if you all recall, Bacon's Rebellion is one of the most important moments in colonial America. Because before Bacon's Rebellion, what did the colonies primarily use for labor? Indentured servants. But then, in Bacon's Rebellion, indentured servants rebelled, and they caused a lot of destruction. So after Bacon's Rebellion, what did we turn to?
Slaves.
We turned to slaves. We're using slaves. So Bacon's Rebellion in Virginia led to a shift from indentured servitude, indentured servants, to slavery. So that's a big moment in U.S. history. Slavery in the Constitution, slavery was a major issue. In 1787, when our founding fathers figured Articles of Confederation are bad, we should go to
Party Warrior Nation. Teachers, pardon this interruption, please take a couple of minutes to check for dress code. Remember the following items to check for. No ripped, torn jeans with holes showing skin above the knee. No short shirts where the midriff is showing. No short shorts or skirts, must be slightly above the knee. No spaghetti straps, no transparent or see-through clothing that reveal undergarments. No tights or yoga pants. No slip-on shoes or flip-flops. No blankets. No clothing with any wording that represents alcohol or tobacco use, profanity or explicit material. No off-colored hair. Hair must be of natural tones. No piercings on the face, only earrings are allowed. No caps or hats or hoodies. Thank you, have a wonderful day.
All right, in 1787, our founding fathers gathered in Philadelphia in what we call the Constitutional Convention, and their goal was to replace the Articles of Federation and write a new constitution. They had a chance to eliminate slavery during that time, to put in the Constitution of the United States that slavery will be banned forever in this new country that we just made. But they didn't take that chance. Slavery continued in the United States, partly because they know the southern states are not going to be in favor of the end of slavery in the United States. So, slavery was a major issue during the Constitutional Convention of 1787. It's not that whether or not we should continue slavery. We did continue slavery. Our founders, even though they had the chance to ban it, they did not ban it and let it continue. In our Constitution, for all the talks about us being the land of the free and the home of the brave, slavery is instituted into our Constitution. We had a 3/5 compromise. It says that each slave will count as how many people for the population? 3/5 of a person. So when we're determining how many seats each state gets in the House of Representatives, we consider each slave as 3/5 of a person. That's in the Constitution, it's still in the Constitution today. You can tell, if you read the Constitution, that our founding fathers were kind of embarrassed about slavery. They know the South is not going to let them get away with removing it in the Constitution. But if you read the Constitution, they didn't call slaves slaves. They would use other euphemisms, other words to describe slaves. Because you can tell that this is something that they're embarrassed about, but they know they had to let it continue. Otherwise, they're not going to get the support of the Southern states. In the Constitution, it put off the end of the international slave trade. 20 years later, they said, we're not going to talk about ending the slave trade until 20 years later in 1808. In 1808, that's when they banned international slave trade in the United States. Did they ban slavery?
No.
No, they just banned trading with other countries, from Africa, shipping slaves from Africa. This will be replaced by an internal slave trade. Where plantations traded slaves with each other instead. In the Constitution, there's a fugitive slave clause. Again, they didn't say the word slave because they're probably embarrassed of it back then. Escaped slaves have to be returned where they came from. That's in the Constitution of the United States. If there's an escaped slave, you capture him. It is your responsibility to return him to the plantation or to the farm where he came from. That's in the Constitution of the United States as well. So horrible, horrible things in this supposedly democratic constitution that we have. After the American Revolution, we saw improvements. Which states started banning slavery?
North.
The northern states, partly because they didn't need them. States in the north will gradually end slavery after the revolution. We saw northern states abolishing slavery in their state, but it still will exist. In the Northwest Ordinance, they banned slavery in the Northwest Territories. We talked about that before. That's the first time the government banned slavery in a particular territory, the federal government did. And then during Monroe's time, we had the Missouri Compromise, where the North and the South were at each other's throat because of the issue of whether or not we should admit Missouri as a slave state. Eventually, that was settled by Henry Clay with the Missouri Compromise. This will postpone a major sectional conflict involving the North and the South. And you'll see, guys, that this is going to happen a lot. Whenever a new state is being admitted to the Union, especially if it's a slave state, there's going to be a lot of conflict between the northern, the free states, and the slave states. And it's going to cause a lot of animosity between the two. But usually, Henry Clay will be there to save the day, try to avert a civil war. But there's going to be a time where Henry Clay's not going to be there to save us anymore, or Henry Clay's going to die, and we're going to be in trouble. In the South, cotton's king. We talked about this before. With the introduction of Eli Whitney's cotton gin, cotton became very profitable. Like I told you before, slavery was on its way out by the early 1800s. It was almost going to die. But then the cotton gin was introduced, and then cotton production became profitable, and having slaves became very profitable. Before the cotton gin, having a slave no longer is losing a lot of people money because you have to feed them, you have to buy them. They cost like a car would cost today. But because of the cotton gin, it made owning a slave very profitable. So it was kind of Eli Whitney's fault, but I'm pretty sure he didn't intend that to happen. The South grew incredibly dependent on cotton production. Grew incredibly dependent on cotton production. If you can see the map on the board, guys, this is cotton production in the South in 1820. And then the cotton gin became popular, and by 1860, look how many of the South is producing cotton already. Demand for land grew. Oh, this is an answer to your homework from last time. Because of the cotton gin and the demand for land grew, Southern states grew and developed very rapidly. States like Louisiana, Mississippi, Alabama, all of them became states right away, partly because a lot of people moved there to plant cotton because cotton was so profitable. However, the negative result of the cotton gin is there was a huge increase in slave labor as well, demand for slave labor. So we talked about that before. Look at this, guys, 719 before the introduction of the cotton gin. Look at how many people, how many slaves lived in the United States. And then by 1860, ever since the introduction of the cotton gin, look how many of the states used slaves afterwards. It's a huge, dramatic increase. I want you to look at this also, Southern population. As you can see, in most of the Southern states, they have a huge what? Look at the legend. They have a huge white population, but they also have a huge what?
Slave
population. In some states, it's almost 50-50. Look at South Carolina. What can you tell me special about South Carolina?
There's more slaves.
There's more slaves than actual white people in South Carolina. So the slave population in the South was a lot. They make up a huge percentage of the population. All right, the market revolution. How is it related to slavery? We'll talk about it right now. The market revolution also fueled the demand for cotton and therefore slaves. In those textile mills of North and those textile mills in Britain, what do they need? What do they need to make clothes? They needed cotton. And where can they get cotton from in a cheap, in a very cheap price? From the South. And what do the South need to produce cotton?
Slaves.
So the North and Britain can pretend all they want to, that they hate slavery, that they want it abolished. But in reality, during the market revolution, because they demanded cotton a lot, indirectly, they were actually supporting what? They were supporting slaves. They wanted cotton to be cheap, and the only way to make cotton cheap is to have free labor, to have slave labor. So the North can pretend all they want to that they're disgusted by slavery, but by buying from the South, by buying cotton from the South, they're actually supporting slavery also. So, Northern and British textile mills demanded Southern cotton. And this is gonna make a lot of people a lot of money. Plantation owners in the South are gonna profit a lot from this. Northern businessmen that own those textile mills are gonna profit. The British are gonna profit a lot from this. And all of this, all of that prosperity, all that money and wealth that's being generated by the trading of cotton and the making of clothes, all of that was built on the backs of who? On slaves. And they're not gonna see a single cent of that. So this will bring prosperity in the North, the South, and Britain that would be built on the backs of slaves. So therefore, Northerners in Britain who had eliminated slavery already indirectly continued to support it. By buying cotton from the South, the North and Britain were paying for slavery. Western expansion and issue of slavery will cause an increase in sectional conflict. Like I told you before, as we expand to the West and new states are getting created, the question about whether or not we should have slave states or free states is always gonna come about. More often than not, Henry Clay comes and saves the day and prevents the crisis, but there's gonna be a time where Henry Clay's not gonna be there to fix the problem, and things are gonna get really, really worse between the North and the South. So, especially between the North and the South. So we talked about the Missouri Compromise before. These two we'll cover later on, so don't worry if you don't know them yet, but you should know the Missouri Compromise already in your head. All of these compromises, a lot of them made by Henry Clay, all of these will just serve to postpone, delay, postpone conflict. It will not end them. The bill always comes due. And we're going to have to pay for the sin of slavery sooner or later. All of these compromises is just going to delay it. All right. When we talk about antebellum South, you should know that in 1861, what's going to happen in the United States?
War.
War between who? The North and the South. There's going to be a time where Henry Clay is not going to be able to delay conflict anymore, that civil war is going to happen. So when we talk about the antebellum South, ante means before. This is the pre-Civil War South. So we're going to talk about what the South was before the Civil War. We're almost there. We're almost in the Civil War, where 600,000 Americans will be dead by the end of 4 years, where we have to pay for slavery with blood. But today, we're going to focus on what the South was like before the Civil War. During the 1800s to about the 1860s, what was it like to live in the South? Everybody knows that. What do they do primarily in the South?
Agriculture.
Primarily agrarian, primarily agriculture. That's what they do. All right. I want you to put a star on the second bullet because we're going to come back to it later on in this class. They have a lack of industrialization. They don't have a lot of manufacturing capability because they didn't need it, because they're earning so much money from what?
Cotton.
From cotton. But that's going to be important, especially during a civil war, and you'll see why. Third, something that's important also, and this is what's sad about the antebellum South. Only about 25% of white families in the South actually owned slaves. Only about 25%. Go and write that down. And out of that 25%, 18% only own about 1 to 9 slaves. So what does that tell you? Most of the white people in the antebellum South actually didn't own what?
Slaves.
They didn't own slaves. They were independent farmers. They were just making it out. And they're poor. Most of them are poor. And they couldn't afford a slave. Like I told you before, owning a slave is like owning a car. It takes a lot of money to be able to buy a slave in the antebellum South. So most of those Southerners, most of the white Southerners, didn't even own slaves. But yet they continued to support the institution of slavery. Why? Because we always have this delusion, and she's exactly right. We always have this delusion that someday we'll make it, right? Someday I can afford a what? I'm going to be able to afford a slave. So some of them, they supported the continuation of slavery because they thought they had this grandeur in their heads that someday I'm going to be like those plantation owners with the big acres and acres of land with hundreds of slaves. So a lot of it is supported by delusion. Most of it is supported by racism. It's just that in the South, like in medieval Europe, there's a hierarchy to things. There's a social hierarchy. Who's at the very top?
White.
Which white people?
Plantation.
Rich, wealthy plantation owners of the South. And then below them are the poor whites, which is most of the population in the South. But there's even people that are below those white trash, which is who? Slaves. They like something, they like to look down on someone. You know, we might be white trash, but at least we're not what? At least we're not slaves. So that motivation, even though most of them didn't own slaves, they're still motivated to support slavery because of those two things. So an overwhelming majority of the white population, most were poor, did not own any slaves, but still supported slavery. Why? They hope that one day they will get to own one. It allowed poor whites to look down on someone in the social hierarchy. All right, let's talk about Southern politics. Southern politics back then, in many ways, is an oligarchy. Should have talked about this in world history. An oligarchy is a government that's controlled by only a few people. That's what it was like in antebellum South. The Southern states were mostly controlled by the wealthy few. The wealthy few. They're the ones that get elected. They're the ones that can vote. Usually the wealthy plantation owners. They're the ones that control the government. They're the ones that control the way things are. The South was very undemocratic. If you compare it to the North, not a lot of the people can vote. They're very undemocratic. All right, another difference between the North and the South back then, unlike the North, there was a lack of immigration in the South. All right, tell me why. Why do the immigrants, like the Irish and the Germans that we've been talking about in this class, why would they move to the North instead of the South?
Jobs.
There's jobs in the North where?
Factories.
In the factories, but there's also jobs in the South.
Happy rich.
What kind of jobs are in the South?
Agriculture.
Farming, right? Could be a farmer. What's the problem? Who are you competing with?
Slaves.
Slaves. And how much do people pay slaves?
Nothing.
You're competing with free labor. It's just hard to do. So not a lot of immigrants migrated to the South because they have to compete with people who aren't getting paid anything. So unlike the North, there was a lot of immigration because of the competition was free labor. Free labor. All right. There were free African American communities in the United States, and you need to know that they existed. There are a lot of people who were free African Americans that were still living in the United States at this point. In the North, they had about 250,000 of them. They had about 250,000 free blacks in the North. African Americans who were not slaves. Who were not owned by anyone. There's going to be a lot of conflict between them and the Irish and the German immigrants because they're competing for the same factory jobs, those unskilled jobs. So there's going to be a lot of racial tension between the immigrants and the free blacks up north. So they will compete with the Irish and German immigrants in the north for jobs, and that's going to lead to a lot of racial conflict between the Irish especially and the free blacks up north. However, they usually do not have a lot of political rights. They can't vote. They can't participate in government. But they certainly have it better than the free blacks living in the South. In the South, believe it or not, there were about 250,000 also of free blacks living in the South. Many were freed slaves. Many were freed slaves.
Freed.
So they were former slaves that were freed. So a lot of them chose to stay in the South. I don't know why, but they chose to stay in the South. So back then, guys, there are ways where a slave can be freed. A lot of the slaves who were fathered by a white man, because a white man slept with a slave, for example, and they had a mulatto child, a half-breed child. A lot of the dads felt sorry for those kids because they're technically their kids. So a lot of them, what did they do to them? They freed them. They didn't allow them to be in bondage. There are a lot of kind plantation owners who allowed their slaves to earn a little money extra if they do a little extra work, and little by little they can save enough money to buy their what?
Freedom.
To buy their freedom. But that's very few instances. Most of the case is very bad for the slaves up there or down there. However, there were many restrictions on free African American communities in the South. They couldn't vote. They had to face a lot of prejudice. There's horrible, horrible stories of free blacks being forced into slavery again. If you ever watch 7 Years a Slave, that was the case. He was a free black, or 12 Years a Slave.
Yeah, he gets drunk.
He's a free black that gets to, I think he was living in Canada.
No, Senator of New York.
No, he was living in Canada. They kidnap them and they force them into slavery again. So that happens a lot. So let's talk about slaves themselves. The South practiced not a humane kind of slavery. What they practiced was chattel slavery. Chattel. We talked about this before. Chattel. C-H-A-T-T-E-L. C-H-A-T-T-E-L. Chattel. Chattel slavery means livestock. Each slave is considered like cattle. You are considered like a pig or a sheep or a cow. You are livestock to the owners of slaves. They were treated like livestock. Horrible, horrible conditions back then. All right, something that we talked about before. Lyman Beecher's daughter, Harriet Beecher Stowe, writes one of the most influential books, novels in U.S. history that's gonna be turned into a play that a lot of Northerners are gonna see. And it illuminated and exposed the cruelty of slavery on African families. How slaves dehumanizes people, how cruel slavery is. Because in case you haven't figured it out by now, this might be a family unit. This might be a mom and a dad in a plantation, but their kids do not belong to them. They belong to the master. And what can happen to the kids? They can be sold off to another plantation, and when that happens, what happens to the family? They get separated and they get broken up. So Uncle Tom's Cabin brought up that issue of families being split up when a family member is sold. Slaves were not given any. It doesn't matter how kind your plantation owner is. You don't get any social, political, or civil rights whatsoever if you're a slave in the South. You can have the best plantation owner in the history of plantation owners, you still don't have rights. I'm sorry. Her book increased the support for which movement? The abolitionist movement. The abolitionist movement. All right. Despite all of this, African Americans in the South were able to come up or create a new culture in the United States. And what African Americans decided or managed to do, it's a great thing. And what they did is they combined their culture from West Africa, where most of them came from, and they mixed it with American culture, and we have what we now call as African-American culture in the United States. The African-American culture that we have today in the United States is a mixture of African traditions back in Africa and American traditions back here at home. they're just mixed up together. So, although most African Americans were in bondage, they still were able to develop their own unique culture. A blend of African and American influences. All right. So during the Second Great Awakening, where the preachers are saying anyone can get to heaven, anyone would include who?
Slaves.
A lot of these slaves were converted to Christianity during the Second Great Awakening. However, keep in mind, a lot of these slaves got over here with a religion already from Africa. They already had their own religions. So what ended up happening is the slaves in the United States, they ended up blending at their African traditions, their African religion, with Christianity, and we get black Christianity in the United States like what it is today. So West African practice of responsorial style of preaching will be blended to Christianity. What that means is, if you've ever seen TV shows or movies, or if you ever attended a predominantly African-American church, it's very different from a white Christian church. What's the difference? They sing in white churches as well.
The dance?
They're more spirited. They're more emotional. There's a back and forth between the audience and the preacher. It's white. They respond. The audience respond to the preacher a lot. And that's not something that came out in America. That's something that they got from where? From Africa. That's what their religion was like. Or they had a back and forth with the audience and the preacher. So that was from Africa. And that's something that still exists today, that audiences will have a back and forth with the preacher. And that's something that they got out of their religion from Africa, that responsorial style of preaching. All right, slaves will develop their own unique style of music and art that blended West African traditions with Christianity, especially when in regards to music. We get something called spirituals. Spirituals, even though the content is Christian, the content talks about Jesus or talks about Christianity, the style comes from where? Comes from West Africa. The notes, the style, the instruments, that comes from Africa. So they were able to blend that to those two cultures. I'll show you an example of one.
Rise in heaven, Lord, for you.
Salam music should be very familiar to most of you, because it's the foundation of Southern music, especially Southern gospel music. But that style came out of West Africa. And the slaves here in the South were able to blend that in there with Christianity. Everybody good so far? Slavery was not taken lying down by the slaves. If you're getting treated like chattel, if you're getting treated like cattle, you're not going to like it. And slaves did resist. But we talked about in this class that there are two types of resistance. Anybody remember what they are?
Covert
and overt. Covert means what?
Secret.
You're secret, you're not open about it. Overt is what?
Open.
Sometimes they would slow their work down. Is that covert or overt?
Covert.
That's covert, right? They would slow down picking cotton. They wouldn't do a good job as they would have otherwise. Breaking tools is also covert. Running away is overt, because they're going to find out. We're going to talk about the Underground Railroad in a little bit, maybe later on, but you should all know what the Underground Railroad is. It's a series. Is that an actual railroad? No, it's just a series of passageways and safe houses where slaves in the South can escape to where?
North.
To the North or to Canada, where they're free. Slave revolts, where slaves actually started rebellions, were not common at all. Because they know what happens when revolutions or revolts are started by slaves. They usually lose, and they usually all get killed off because of it. There was one famous one that happened before the American Revolution that killed a lot of people. But after that, a lot of slaves were scared of revolting. A lot of them, instead of rebelling, decide to just leave. At least they can preserve their life. So escape is better than rebellion. So we get the Stonewall Rebellion before the American Revolution in South Carolina. Their slaves rebelled against their masters during the colonial period. So this is when we're not America yet. This was a long time ago, Stonewall Rebellion. Here's what you should know, guys. After the American Revolution, we've had a few, they're not very common, we had a few slave rebellions, but almost all of them did not result in any white people dying. So there's one famous attempt of a revolution. Denmark Vesey in South Carolina, again, was planning a massive slave revolt, a massive rebellion by slaves. Unfortunately, one of the people that he was working with in the revolution, in the rebellion, I'm sorry, he betrayed Denmark Vesey, and the rebellion was stopped there. It didn't really come into anything. The most famous slave revolution was slave revolt after the American Revolution. This one is important, that's why there's stars in it, is Nat Turner's Rebellion. Nat Turner's slaves in Virginia led slaves in Virginia into a revolt. What's special about this is, for the first time since the American Revolution, a slave revolt, which is a peaceful protest, but here's something that's special about this case. This is a freedom of speech case, like all of you should know. This is a freedom of expression case. But what's special about this case is there was nothing written and there was nothing spoken. This is what we call symbolic speech. This is the first time the Supreme Court has heard something like this, where nobody has said anything, nobody wrote anything down. Is it still protected? Is expression that is nonverbal, which is what we call symbolic expression, is it still protected by the First Amendment's protection on freedom of speech? Furthermore, this is a struggle, again, between freedom of speech and the school's interests. Because what's the school trying to do by banning these armbands? They're trying to preserve what? They're trying to preserve social order. They don't want any distractions in education. They don't want anybody to disturb education of the students. So that's why they banned that. So what the Supreme Court has to figure out is, what's more important to them? Is it freedom of speech, or is it preserving the social order of a school? All right. So what they did, the school did, is they suspended the kids for refusing to remove the armbands. The parents complained, and we got the court case, Dinker versus Des Moines. So So IO teens Mary and John Thinker staged a peaceful protest of the Vietnam War by wearing black armbands to their public schools. School officials announced that the student had to remove their armbands or face suspension, or face getting suspended, suspension. The students refused to remove their armbands, resulting in their suspensions. Their parents filed suit against the school district, claiming that the school violated the students' what rights?
Speech.
Freedom of speech. Students' freedom of speech rights, First Amendment. The question the Supreme Court has to answer, well, before that, an important thing to note, the students' protest did not take written or spoken form. It wasn't written, it wasn't spoken, but instead used symbolic speech or expression. Is that protected by the First Amendment? The Supreme Court will have to answer that. So, two questions. Is symbolic speech protected by the First Amendment? And number two, did the school district violate their freedom of speech? The answer is yes. The Supreme Court ruled that wearing black armbands was a form of symbolic speech, which they said is protected by the First Amendment. So even though expression is nonverbal, it's still protected by the First Amendment. Furthermore, the court found that the silent protest did not interfere with the school's ability to operate normally. The school was complaining, if we allow these armbands in there, education of the kids will be disturbed. The court said, it's not. It doesn't do anything. Wearing black armbands is not going to disturb anyone. It's not. The school can continue operating normally, whether or not those kids have black armbands on them or not. It's just the school making too much of a big deal out of it. So they decided the school's complaint of armbands disrupting education was invalid. So what won in this case? Freedom of speech or social order?
Freedom of speech
won. Symbolic speech, this is the impact, was confirmed to be protected under the First Amendment, which means expression that doesn't take verbal form is now protected by the First Amendment, like protesting, marching, sit-ins, all of that stuff, now protected by the First. Even burning the flag of the United States is protected by the First Amendment.
What?
Yes.
But that was illegal.
No. In 1990, there was a case called Texas v. Johnson. There was a Texas law that banned flag burning in the state of Texas. Johnson did it anyways. So he set fire to the flag as a form of protest. He gets arrested for it. The Supreme Court said that is symbolic speech. And according to a previous court case, which is what?
Thinkers
versus Des Moines, what are we doing here?
Symbolic.
What is the court doing?
Flying
a president, what do we call that?
Stare decisis.
All right. So the Supreme Court's interpretation of the First Amendment reflects a commitment to individual liberty over the interests of the school. So individual liberty won out in this particular case. It's not always going to win. There are times that social order, the government's interest, is more important according to the Supreme Court. So let's talk about those cases. While freedom of speech is a right, it is not an absolute right. It is not absolute. Even though you have the right to freedom of speech, it is not an absolute right, which means it can be restricted. It can be regulated. It can still be subject to some restrictions according to the interpretations of the Supreme Court. The first one we're going to talk about happened in 1919. What's happening in 1919?
Oh, World War
I. World War I. We got Schneck. I don't know if that's how you pronounce the name or if that's how we're going to pronounce it in this class. Schneck versus the United States. During World War I, Schneck and a couple of his comrades disagreed with the draft. So what they did, this is a peaceful thing, what they did is they printed out 15,000 flyers and distributed it all over the United States, telling people to resist the draft, not to participate in the draft, resist it, because they believe the draft is forced servitude. You are being forced to serve, which should be a violation of which amendment?
14.
What ban forced servitude, and they not, what's another word for forced servitude? If you're being forced to serve, that's slavery. What banned slavery in the United States? The 13th. So they said this is a violation of 13th. The draft is a violation of 13th Amendment because we are being forced to serve in the military, which is basically an equivalent to slavery. You don't need to know that, but that's their complaint. This is a freedom of speech deal. There was a law in the United States called the Espionage Act. And the Espionage Act outlaws people to interfere with military recruitment. So you cannot interfere with the military recruiting people into the army, including the draft. You cannot interfere with the draft. That is a criminal act. So they arrested Schneck and his comrades, and we get the court case, Schneck versus United States. The question is that law, the Espionage Act, which prevents people from interfering with the recruitment, with the draft, is it a violation of the First Amendment? Is Schneck's right to freedom of speech being violated in this particular case? All right, let's throw this out. During World War I, Congress passed the Espionage Act, which outlawed interfering with military what? Recruitment. Carl Schneck and Elizabeth Baer mailed 15,000 flyers urging men to resist the military draft during through peaceful means. They weren't calling for violence, through peaceful means. The two were convicted under the Espionage Act for interfering with military recruitment. They appealed to the Supreme Court on the grounds that the law violated their First Amendment right to freedom of speech. All right, so the constitutional question. Were Schneck's actions protected by the freedom of speech?
No.
Those of you that studied this over there, right, you know that they didn't. This particular action, this particular speech, is not protected by the First Amendment. Why not?
Because it could cause danger in the social
media. Exactly. This is, again, the interest of the government to preserve national what? National security and social order versus civil liberties. In this particular case, what won out? Social order, national security won out versus your individual liberty. So no, Schneck's actions were not protected by the free speech clause of the First Amendment. The court upheld the Espionage Act ruling that speech creating, and this is something important, this is the precedent established by Schneck versus the United States, clear and present danger, clear and, I don't think I gave you enough space, I'm sorry, clear and present danger was not protected by the First Amendment. If a speech presents a clear and present danger, which the Supreme Court believed those flyers were doing, it's going to cause a clear and present danger of a riot happening in the United States, especially during wartime, then it is not allowed. Clear and present danger doctrine. Now, the court was they tried to explain themselves very well during this time. They said, if this took place at any other time in U.S. history, this would have been fine. But we are what? We are a war. And sometimes during war, there are some things that cannot be permitted because it can cause some dangers, and this particular one, they believe it's going to cause some riots. If they continue doing that, it's going to cause rebellions, so they did not allow it because they think it's clear and present danger. So the court took into account the context in which the speech was made. It was during wartime, and they believe such speech is dangerous. The fact that it was wartime made Schneck's actions potentially dangerous. So the impact, the court established the clear and present danger doctrine. The clear and present danger doctrine. That's why you can't shout fire at a crowded building, you can't shout bomb at an airport, because those kind of speeches present clear and present danger. That's established by Schneck versus United States. But more importantly for us, in this case, the court prioritized the federal government's interests for social order and national security over your right to freedom of speech. social order and national security won out over freedom of speech. All right, other restrictions. Time, place, and manner regulations. The Supreme Court has ruled that some regulations time, place, and manner regulations on speech may be enacted, especially if the speech infringes on someone else's freedom and incite danger. So what this basically means, guys, there are certain circumstances where the courts or where the government can control, can regulate when a speech is to be made, when a speech is to be made, where is it going to be made, and how it's going to be made. So government can control that. So for example, government can ban people having a party at 12 a.m. in the morning in a regular household. They can control the time. Government can ban protests in the middle of a busy street, in the middle of an intersection. Because if you are protesting in the middle of an intersection, you are violating somebody else's right to freedom of movement. So government can regulate that. It's not protected by freedom of speech. If you are playing your speakers very, very loudly in that kind of manner at an orphanage or a church, that's something that can be regulated. So examples, government can forbid loud protests in front of someone's house in the middle of the night. Government can forbid sit-in protests in the middle of a busy intersection during rush hour. So those are time, place, and manner restrictions. Those are perfectly okay as long as there's a good reason, a reasonable reason to do it. Defamatory speech is something that would damage somebody's reputation with false statements. Those can be restricted also. Those can be punishable and criminalized. So we have two kinds, slander and libel. What's the difference? Libel is written. Go and write that down. Libel is written. Slander is SSS. Slander is what? Spoken. Libel is written. Slander is spoken. Again, these are false statements made to endanger somebody or damage their reputation. They have to be, you have to prove though, that they were purposely made falsely. They have to know that it was false. Like I can accuse Derek of killing babies, right? But that can't be defamation because I don't know whether or not he kills babies. Number three, hate speech. Written or spoken communication that belittles a group based on its characteristics, such as race, sexuality, gender, and all that stuff. You should know. Anybody know the church?
No.
That's the Westboro Baptist Church. They're like the poster child for hate speech. In the United States, hate speech is protected. This is protected speech. It's usually protected. They would have symbols like God hates fags and God wanted your soldier to die, stuff like that. Very hateful speech. That is allowed by the Supreme Court. That's how they make money, because people try to sue them and they use the First Amendment to win the case, and that's how they get the money. So this is when hate speech is not allowed. Hate speech is not allowed as long as it doesn't incite imminent lawless action. As long as it doesn't incite imminent lawless action. And as long as it doesn't try to trigger lawless action, it's allowed. All right, guys, we'll have your, you have a homework assignment tonight. You have two tonight.
Here's our one
word. Yeah, we'll do that tomorrow. We don't want to get caught.